Welcome to the video. We're going to use a visual aid here of this blackboard, and we're going to talk about the most important issue right now is to see the big picture in hindsight of what's going on, so you can kind of stabilize yourself within this knowledge. What we have here is a depiction of two cycles overlapping. This cycle here, called cycle one, goes up till basically, I would say, October of 2013. And it extends all the way here to just before 2014. This is cycle one. Cycle two started basically in 1980. Okay, it started in 1980 right here and extends into the future. So this is the past here. This is the future. This is cycle two. They overlap. Okay, they overlap. So about a year, there's a year prior, 1979 is when this overlap is almost ready to begin. And you will feel that, okay, something is really about ready to happen. And then 2014, when we reach 2014, or actually the cycle, I would say sometime maybe after October or during October of 2013, is when the first cycle is really left behind entirely. Okay, so we are very close to this point right here where this cycle one is going to be truly left behind in a very profound way, actually. The will of the world will pivot its attention to cycle two. Okay, now this overlap, where the cycles overlap, it's very interesting. It's a 33-year period. This is what hindsight has shown us. 33-year period from 1980 through 2013. I believe it really started in October of 1979. So it would end, it would seem, let's just keep it at 1980. There was the build-up to it. The build-up to it started in that time. One year node period right here. And there's going to be a one-year node period there. But let's just say 1980 through 2013. 33 years of overlapping. During this time, we have what is called a stalemate, where the ways of the old cycle one and the ways of cycle two, they're both present and they're clashing. At first, cycle two comes in and we say, oh, what is all this new stuff? What is this stuff? And you say, well, it's kind of interesting, but you know, we'll see how it works out. Gradually, cycle two gains prominence, and then cycle one is saying, whoa, wait a minute, it seems like we're being kicked to the curb here. And there's a lot of angst and concern because the ways of cycle one are being replaced by the ways of cycle two. And when cycle two comes in to the picture back here, the people that are being born into the world by and large are carrying the attitudes, goals, aspirations, beliefs, everything of cycle two. They have it with already programmed within them. So, and it's very, very, very different, actually. So there's a tremendous generational gap, as it were. Over these 33-year period, we find people more and more and more see that there's a big gulf between their perspectives and their beliefs. The younger generation, let's say 33 and younger at this time, is very much, by and large, oriented towards cycle two. And the older generation is by and large oriented still to cycle one. And it seems like they're two different, very, very different. One moment, please. So this explains why there's just this enormous difference between the people 33 and under, by and large, and people older than that. They just have very different mindsets, especially the people who were born several decades before 1980 started. Okay, you know, they are more rooted in cycle number one. Now, the point of showing you this is the stalemate. 33 years stalemate. And I call this the time of grace. Time of grace. Because during these 33 years, we're sort of in a limbo land, as it were, a stalemate, where neither cycle seems to be predominating. So cycle one, if you didn't like cycle one, you might be saying, hey, you know, I'm finally able to express why I don't like cycle one, because cycle two is bringing in this energy, is sort of buffering it and stalemating it. And so you're able to examine cycle one very clearly and say, wow, and see what it was about and say, boy, I really, really didn't like that cycle. Likewise, those who are of cycle two may be coming into this world, and because they're being buffered by cycle one here, stalemated by it, they have an opportunity to examine their cycle, the beliefs of cycle two, and say, you know what? I don't like the beliefs of cycle two. I don't want to really be part of that. And so they're able to use the time wisely too. So actually, there are two types of people that are able to benefit from the stalemate, time of stalemate, this 33-year stalemate. I call it the period, time of grace. It is the time of grace. It is those from cycle one who say, I just hate cycle one, and let me re-examine it. And then also saying, and those from cycle two who say, I really don't like this, what cycle two stands for, because the people of cycle two have already been in this cycle, actually, for a long time. It's just overlapping here on planet Earth at this time. So they know what it's about. I call it the fourth dimensionals. They know what it's about. And they may be saying, I hate this cycle I've been in. And finally, it's being stalemated here on planet Earth with this previous cycle. And so I can reassess what's been going on, and I can choose a different idea. I can get free of this. So you have some under the age of 33 and younger who are like this, who say, whoa, you know, what a great thing that I've been able to get free of this cycle too. And those of cycle one saying, what a great thing I've been able to get free of cycle one. And at the same time, during this 33-year stalemate period, the realization can dawn that all cycles are terrible. You don't want either cycle one or cycle two. That's the great thing about it. You see, so there are those age 33 who are getting it. And there are those under the age of 33 are getting it. They're just getting it from, you know, either from cycle one or cycle two during this stalemate period. So not everybody 33 and younger is totally in the cycle two. Not everyone, no. Most are. But some are saying, whoa, 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 I'm tired of this. I know what it's all about. I don't want it. So very interesting that 33 is the number of spiritual perfection. It's also the age of Jesus, supposedly, when how many years he lived on this planet. Now, I believe that the 33 that Jesus showed us was alerting us to this overlap period between two cycles and the necessity to use this to our utmost advantage. Why do I believe that? Because I will write it in here. One moment. Because Jesus managed to get a book published in this world by giving sort of a telepathic dictation called A Course in Miracles, ACIM. And it came out in this period just before this overlap began. I believe it was actually put in bookstores maybe in 1976, and I saw a copy in a bookstore in 1978. So just before cycle two really began to be felt in this period, like 1 year before, 78 through 79, I came across A Course in Miracles, which is an incredible course in reason and clarity and guidance. Also in the in October, starting in late October, October 27th, 1979, was it, or 78? 78, I think it was. Yeah, 78. I began having tremendous breakthroughs in spiritual enlightenment, actually, dawned upon me at that time for briefly. And then I began to study A Course in Miracles very earnestly. So that was a year grace period before the 1980 period kicked off, maybe October 78 through October 79. And then in 1980, this stalemate began. So I'm sure that Jesus is very much aware of this stalemate period, a time of grace where it is possible, comes very possible, to drop your interest in cycles altogether. You say, cycle ones, I don't like it. I'm able to see that. And then cycle two, you say, whoa, I don't like this either. I don't want either one. I don't want either one. So this A Course in Miracles is a very advanced teaching, I believe, specifically for this time of grace during the stalemate between overlapping cycles. Also, again, Jesus' life, 33 years, I believe it was a symbolic sort of thing. There's a tremendous amount of symbology, actually, in that whole story about Jesus. And I believe it was pointing out at the end of the age, there will be this overlap between the cycles, and this will be your time of greatest opportunity. So we get this tremendous clarification from Jesus about what his teaching really is during just before this overlap period. And I came across this a year before this overlap period began, and I was able to get momentum going into this time and was able to carry the momentum all the way through to where we are now, October 2013. Now, from October 2013 to October 2014, this is the period, a 1 year period, where the new cycle shakes free of the old cycle. So it'd be like a 1 year period where people just kind of turn their attention entirely away from cycle one. Just as in cycle one, there was a beginning, that 1 year period where we realized that cycle one was about to come to an end, as it were, go through this stalemate. There's a realization this stalemate time was coming, and now it 214, October 213 through October 214, there's a realization that this stalemate period is now, we're leaving it, it's finished. So we're just about now at that time where the realization that we're leaving cycle one permanently, is now is dawning upon us, which is why many of us are feeling like really down, deflated and tired and listless. And just I went through a month of extreme anxiety from September through to the month of September. It was just horrific, horrific. I don't even want to think about it. It's been so bad. And I really just feel like I cannot go on any further. Which is probably true, because I don't want to go into cycle number two. So we have to ask, well, what do we do? What do we do? What is the situation? A little more clarification. So let me work on this here. What I've been shown during this 33-year stalemate time of grace period by the Holy Spirit, by the Holy Spirit, is that there's a possibility of refuge. You don't have to go into cycle number two. That is what I have seen, and what I have been guided towards. Is there's another option that transcends cycles altogether. It's the perfect no. It's the vision of Christ. It's there is something that there's a perception which will free us from all cycles permanently. And we didn't get into that next. But before we move on, let me just reiterate that this 33-year period of cycle overlap, which produces a stalemate, can be used to incredible advantage. It is a time of opportunity where you can literally get an overview of existence and see what it is and realize you don't want it. And for me, that's what has happened. I was able to do an all-out sprint. For 33 years, I have been in full-on emergency mode of just complete all-out dedication every single day, never missing a single day during this 33-year period. So I just realized I have to go for it. And that's what I did. And the result is being able to recognize these cycles of existence, and getting a cosmic overview of existence and recognizing existence for what it really is, and recognizing how to get free of existence, and all of that in a 33-year period of intense effort has taken place. So certainly if there are those who don't get it during this overlap, there will be other cycles overlapping other cycles. Cycles always overlap. Okay, so there's grace periods continuously arise throughout the cosmos where there's a temporary stalemate as cycles overlap, where that the stalemate allows spirit to say, wait a minute, you know, you're not carried forward so much by the momentum of a cycle, and you have an opportunity. The opportunity arises. So when it arises, you have to go for it like it's life or death. You are going to be amazed. You will be amazed at how much you can benefit from that. But there may be those in this particular overlap who are ready to graduate, as it were. So let's see what I can do here with this. I'm erase this probably and be right with you. During the time of stalemate, we've had this situation where cycle one and cycle two, the different attitudes have sort of offset each other. An example would be like Vatican II, which didn't happen in 1980, it happened back before that. But it was a situation where there's a great divide among the idea of how you go about your business, and as far as church business goes. A lot of people, the old guard says, no, Vatican II is terrible. It's going to be ruinous. And a lot of people say, wait a minute, let's give it a try. So right now, after this 33 period, what has happened with that? The new Pope has definitely made it crystal clear that the old guard, pre-Vatican II, it's finished. It's the stalemate is over. It's finished. They're going full blast into the new way, the new church, as it were. So there's one example. You also have politically, you have the conservatives and the progressives. You call them liberals, progressives, whatever. And there's been enormous struggle between these two groups over the last 33 years. And great division, and we're seeing that division right now come to a head. And people in the world are just saying, you know what, this stalemate is so terrible, we just need to junk the whole thing, let's go with a different direction, which is the purpose of cycle two. Cycle two is going to go in a different direction towards a one world governance, to eliminate nationality, sovereignty, a global governance, global laws, global court, global currency, all this stuff is globalism. And just today I was reading comments about the impasse in Washington over the budget, and I was amazed by the comments. Everybody with maybe one, and saying, we have to get rid of all of them. Just clean house. The system is broken. Get rid of everything. Of course, mostly young people are commenting on internet forums. So, obviously, it's an easy step from there to globalism. Okay? They say the system doesn't work. And, of course, the older perspective would say, well, wait a minute. Who holds the veto power? Who is saying it's my way or the highway? Obviously, the POTUS is saying that, but nobody blamed the POTUS at all in the comments. Nothing. It was all Congress's fault, which to me is a clear-cut indicator that the young 33 and under, they want global governance, period. Okay. They're not, they want the big leader, the big bureaucracy. They don't want this, you know, checks and balances anymore. And so they're not blaming the leader at all, the one who's saying, you either pass it my way or I'll veto it and you'll get nothing. Not even mentioning that. Amazing. So there's another stalemate that is now, I believe, it is going to come to an end. People are fed up. And the cultural wars have been raging the last 33 years. Abortion, of course. I'm not sure when Roe versus Wade happened. I could look it up. But that's been festering in the world for a long, long time now. That, you know, and it just, you know, gay marriage is another one. Okay, that whole equality, marriage equality type of thing, that has also been huge battles. I mean, the last 33 years, you know, every single day, there's some, you know, some issue about the fight between, you know, traditional definitions of morality, of relationship, of marriage, and all of that relating, and then the battle with the all the new definitions, where the 33 and under crowd feel not only accepting of gay marriage and equality and all that, but boosterish about it. As like, this is like the answer, it's just super important, you know. So incredibly different ideologies. Tattoos, for instance, prior to 1980, I can tell you that tattoos, there were no tattoos except on sailors, and never saw them. I just didn't see tattoos at all. Going through school, I can't remember a single tattoo ever. Now, it's unbelievable. You go out in public, and just look, and the 33 and younger crowd, as it were, they all have tattoos almost. Almost all of them have tattoos. And you say, what in the world is going on? Say, for the mindset prior to this overlap, it's inconceivable that people be going around with tattoos on their faces, their necks, their arms. Completely inconceivable. Much of what is taking place in cycle two is really inconceivable to cycle one. Just absolutely off the map entirely. Gay marriage is another one. Nobody ever considered that it could ever be a possibility, ever. It's still like flabbergasted. I mean, what in the world are people thinking? But cycle two thinks that's the greatest thing ever since, you know, popcorn. So there's this incredible divide between cycle one and cycle two. And there's been an incredible stalemate. You have the stalemate between people who believe in God and atheists. Whereas back in prior to the stalemate period, atheism just was hardly existed, as far as nobody, you know, paid much heed to it at all. There was agnosticism, etc. But there wasn't this virulent type of atheism. But that started, and there's been this tug of war between lawsuits, you know, saying you can't have any mention of religion here. You know, Christmas, I mean, it's inconceivable for cycle oneers to think that God could be taken out of Christmas and Christ could be taken out of Christmas, whereas cycle twoers think that Christ should have no place in Christmas. And this is just like unbelievable difference, you know. It's just inconceivable to both sides. Much of the ideologies are inconceivable one to another. Cycle one to cycle two, they just don't get it. Cycle two to cycle one, they just don't get it. There's just disconnect between the cycles, very much so. And what happens is that the new cycle two, gradually beats down cycle one through many, many laws, through constant propaganda, and they gradually impose their will through advanced technology. And cycle two gradually is being chopped down by a thousand cuts, torture of a thousand cuts, really, is what it is. And it has been torturous, there's no question. Having gone through this, I'd say, what is it like? Torture, brutal torture is what it's been like. That's the best you can say, from my standpoint, the best you can say is that it's been like brutal torture. So, you know, I don't blame it on cycle tours, I blame it on existence itself, absolutely. So existence is brutal, it's torturous. There's no question about it. And this overlap time gives one the opportunity to really see how terrible it is, because it's really been terrible. The imposition of cycle two's ideologies and beliefs upon cycle one has just been, you know, like the colonists taking over the Indians of North America. I mean, that was brutal, brutal torture, wasn't it? Absolutely it was. That was a kind of a minor overlap type of thing there, of different races, root races and ideologies. And that, how did that work out for the Indians? It was brutal torture for them, no question about it. And that, but that gave them an opportunity just to realize, whoa, existence is really terrible. Look at this. Just like now, on a larger scale, we can realize, hey, existence is just awful. Totally awful. There's no two ways about it. And then that opens our ears to the teachings such as A Course in Miracles, which points out just how completely vicious the ego's whole program and training program is, how terrible it really is, and how all super important it is to choose the grace of the Holy Spirit to get free of that. So there's a silver lining to it all, which is, because it's so terrible, one makes extra efforts to find a way of freedom from existence. That's the silver lining. it's a tough thing for sure. I mean, I remember coming into this world, and I was very much against coming back into this world. Very downcast, depressed, serious as a child. I was all business saying, I'm going to hate this, absolutely hate this life. There was no carefreeness. No, I was just like totally bummed out from the very beginning, because I knew what I was getting into just a hornet's nest, and it was not going to be any fun at all. So, but I had this attitude of, I just need to work as hard as I can, you know, just for a certain time period. And eventually the benefits would accrue from that. So I took this attitude of just absolute focus on spiritual teaching from the very beginning. No, you know, all this other stuff, forget it. Forget it. All the good times, all the fun stuff. No, leave me alone. Leave me alone. I'm not interested in any of that stuff. This is serious, serious time right now. And it turned out to be right. It turned out to have the right guidance as far as just how serious this overlap time has been. And the incredible opportunity to free one's spirit, from the spirit to get free of existence itself, first by the Holy Spirit's resolution of the continuity problem. So I would say that I have, you know, benefited immeasurably from the work, the time, the overlap time, and the willingness to embrace the challenge. Embrace the challenge. A Course in Miracles came in, I embraced the challenge. I said, this is it. This is going to help get me up to speed. And completely embraced all of that. And then followed through by working every day and don't take a day off. Otherwise, cycle two is going to get you. It's going to get you. As a new cycle begins, it's very potent, very attractive, very glamorous, very seductive. The ideology just can get into you, and just just inflate you to a terrible extent where you are willing to embrace a long period of time, another cycle of existence. You're willing to embrace a whole other cycle of existence. Just imagine that. Not just a lifetime, a cycle of existence. That's how inflated the ideology becomes. And that's what's happened. So it's fighting against this inflation is a terrible struggle, actually. But the stalemate allows that because neither side really quite has the advantage over the other during the stalemate period. And we have seen tremendous battles take place politically, socially, religious-wise, and over this 33-year period, just a massive, massive conflict and turmoil between these two cycles. But what I am seeing and saying now is that time period is now over, and we will see the next year as a time when we people really leaving the memory of cycle one behind. It's just going to be a time of launching. Cycle two will just launch itself, you know, and this is the way now. This is how it is. This healthcare thing is very important. It's crucial, actually. That's which is why there's this huge last-ditch stand against this Affordable Health Care Act, because literally, that is the game changer. When you put your literal health and well-being in the hands of a bureaucracy, you know, that is just, you can't take a more drastic step than that. Which is why those from Cycle One absolutely oppose that so much, so much. I'm totally opposed to the basic principles of it. I understand that, you know, supposedly it's going to help a lot of people out, but the flip side is I cannot see myself involved in that at all, at all. I mean, I don't even go to doctors. I don't even want any health care. So, you know, it's just, it's unthinkable. The future, for cycle oneers, the future seems like it can't be navigated properly. There's no way to navigate it, because ideologically, we're so opposed to every facet of it, so many facets of it, that we can't just flow through, like a river just flowing through, and because we're not embracing it. Everything, we stop, and we freeze up, and we get very upset and irritated, and say, well, I don't want to do that. I was just told yesterday, younger people tell me things, and they say that to apply for a job now, it has to be done online, at least in the Silicon Valley. You have to do it online. The entire culture is being changed in such a way that you either embrace it or you cannot survive it. And the realization is upon me. Now, theoretically, I can do that kind of stuff, but I don't want to. See, I don't really want to. I don't want to go along with that because it leads into ever more down the rabbit hole type of situations. And you will find yourself, you know, lost in space, actually. Just utterly inundated. I mean, just fourth dimensional ideologies, you know, are really great time delayers. They really delay realization. It's all about delaying realization. 1 minute, please. Now, by the way, are you all familiar, I'm sure you are, with this symbol? This is, you know, the classic fist symbol, right? That Christians use, meaning Jesus. Okay, well, what does this symbol really mean? I will show you. It's really a symbol representing the overlap, okay? You have cycle one here, cycle two here. The overlap is actually this fist symbol. Remove the lines, as it were, and you have this fist symbol, you see. That, and then they put the name Jesus inside this fist symbol. 33 years of life, 33 years of this stalemate, the overlap of cycles. That is the true significance of the symbol. They use the Greek letters for Jesus. They put that in there. But again, this is actually shows the overlap of cycles. So here we have it, cycle one, cycle two, this overlap, which is the fish symbol, 33-year overlap. And of course, the number of years Jesus was reported to be in the world, 33 years. What was the time of Jesus? A time of grace. It symbolizes the grace of God. So this overlap period of the cycles, where there's a stalemate, is the time, optimum time, the grace of God, meaning you can turn to the grace of God instead of to the ego's plan. Existence is the ego's plan. Again, it's really mind presenting a training program to spirit, because spirit wants to not be what it is, because it wants to be greater than what it is. It wants to be God. Spirit decided it wants to be prime creator, not just spirit. So what to do has to not be what it is. How do you do that? And spirit said, mind, I want you to find a way so I'm not what I am. And mind says, okay, there's a way. Invented a way. There's a training program for you, and it'll teach you how to die, to not be what you are. Annihilation, death, all right? It'll teach you that. And spirit says, really? Wow, that's incredible. Okay, I'm all in. Let's see how it goes. Then they have all these cycles, and these cycles are just continually remarketing, repackaging. They're just repackaging the training program. That's all it is. You go to the gym one day and it looks on one way, then they remodel it. Go through remodeling, you come in, now it's got waterfalls and birds and butterflies and scent therapy and all this stuff. But the machines are still there, and you're working out, but they're more sophisticated machinery. It's just a repackaging of this training program, is all the cycles are. So as you get one cycle coming to an end, the other cycle getting ready to start, there's this overlap period. And you have the opportunity at that time, the grace of God, to recognize what is existence. What is existence, actually? It's a training program. And you can realize, I don't want this training program. And then you come upon the great insight that your problem is really the continuity problem, is you're afraid to drop this training program because you feel you'd be disoriented. And this disorientation may go on forever. You can't remember how to function in reality. In other words, you don't know how to function through knowing. What we're functioning now is through perception and reaction and information and data and all this stuff. In reality, we don't function that way. We function as knowing. There's a perfect knowingness at all, every moment. So we feel we wouldn't be able to function. We can't remember how to function. So we're not willing to set these cycles down, to drop perception. We're not willing to drop perception. We just aren't. And that gives rise to this. Whenever we feel like dropping perception, we freak out, we panic, and then we say, oh, I need to embrace the training program. I'd rather have death than eternal disorientation. And so we jump into, a cycle and try to learn how to love the cycle, love the training, all the misery, the hell of it all. We say, no, this is great. This is good for me. These are lessons I need to learn. that's the year that, the earth is a schoolroom. These are lessons I need to learn in order to grow and to evolve into what I can become and all this stuff. That is simply rationale. Rationalizing the attempt to learn to love the training program, the death-based training program, out of fear of the continuity problem. Absolutely. Once you start getting over the fear of the continuity problem, all the stuff you did previously, you realize it was just a rationalization. And you forgive yourself for it. You forgive yourself. You say, I was just so blinded and scared. I was willing to try and buy into all this stuff, which I knew it was phony, but I said, It's better than the alternative. I was afraid of the continuity issue. There's something inside of us that knows, that says, all this stuff is nonsense. St. Paul says, hey, I no matter how much I try to love Christ, I keep getting pulled back into the flesh. That's why the fear of the continuity issue is what causes that. So all forgiveness is actually self-forgiveness. We have to forgive ourselves for being so frightened that we kept doing things that we knew, we didn't really like. Of course, we don't really like existence. Those people who say they do are pretending. They're just trying to, trying to learn to love it. And they say, well, I'm not quite there yet. You hear that too. The end of their lives, they'll say, oh, I spent a whole life trying to learn to love the world, and I'm, I just failed. I feel so sinful. I failed. I just still don't love the world. That's no sin. Absolutely not. Jesus didn't come here to compromise, didn't say, hey, choose both cycles, learn to love both cycles. He said, I came to bring a sword of division, a sword of discrimination, a sword of decision, okay, to decide once and for all during this grace period. Decide whether you want to continue on with this training program with its relentless cycles of brutality, or do you want to choose the Holy Spirit's remedy? Okay, that is the question. The resolution to the continuity issue is the big issue. Once you decide that the Holy Spirit really does have the answer to the continuity issue, then you start to say goodbye to the cycles of existence. You no longer feel so trapped in these cycles. You don't feel like you need to learn to love them so you can speak out against them and say they're terrible. The continuity problem is our only problem. That is it. We don't really have any other problem. This is the big one. But it is so big. The continuity problem is so gigantic, so intimidating, so frightening. It's just overwhelming. So people may ask, how do you solve that? How is this continuity problem resolved? We can talk about it. But ultimately, one has to take baby steps with the grace and guidance of the Holy Spirit to gradually ease towards acceptance of the resolution of this. There's no way that anybody can actually definitively teach this to anyone else. It's too frightening. That so many defenses will arise. So I would say literally you have to use the stalemate period to look at this and gradually find your way, crawl your way towards it. It's really a matter of crawling your way. You're not running, it's crawling. Because each step seems fraught with difficulty. Every little crawl you take, you think, oh my gosh, this is really scary. Say, it is. It is. I didn't just waltz towards it. No, it's every step, every little advance was very scary. Because it seems like you're risking eternal disorientation. It's going to bite you at any second. And gradually, it melts away. Gradually, it melts away. But it's more of a melting than anything else. You don't shatter. You don't shatter. You don't break it. The fear sort of melts away like an ice cube melting, is what really happens. And you finally you feel not so bothered by the issue at all. And that's where I'm at right now. So this is just something to, you know, add to your understanding. And who knows? Some will do it now, some will do it down the road, but this seeds the, you know, the idea is seeded within. Like, you know what? It is possible. It is possible. And there's a lot of avenues to get out of a cycle in some way. You can actually, let's say you're someone who's in cycle two and you decide, I don't really like the cycle two. I want to get free of cycles. You can find yourself taking a birth upon a place in the cosmos where this overlap is taking place. Or you may be born just before it, like I was. And then when it does take place, then you can put maximum effort towards acceptance of that the Holy Spirit has solved the continuity problem. Accepting that it's solution to the continuity problem, which is the only solution there is. That is a way to do it. Absolutely, that is a way to do it. So instead of just taking life after life after life, birth after birth after birth, in a new cycle, you can say, no, let me go to some place where there's an overlap, where there's a stalemate. And then I can focus on this. So you might be saying, well, I don't think I've got it yet. And I don't think I'll be able to get it right now, et cetera, et cetera. Well, again, that's okay. Because it may be your next life, you can position yourself. You'll choose to position yourself in just the right place so that you can get it. All right. And interestingly enough, when you do that in a world, you will find that there have been teachers in that world, really great teachers, just prior to the overlap. What happens is just prior to the overlap, great teachers come into the world. show you this. Here's an example of what I'm talking about. First teacher, Ramana Maharshi, born in 1879, interestingly enough, 100 years prior to, I think it was December of 79, basically 100 years prior to this stalemate overlap period, the beginning of it in the end of 1979, beginning of 1980, and passed away, left in 1950, and then on to Myanmar, 1896 to 1982. Interesting enough, stayed here just through the very beginning of this stalemate period. She actually started really withdrawing, really withdrawing in the 79, 80, starting about 79, I believe. You could tell that her mission here was essentially done. So these were two great teachers here that built up the spiritual aspirations of people prior to the overlap stalemate period, where people said, you know what, there is something for us that we can really get free of our perception, free of this world. We can see a vision of oneness. We can abide in this bliss. You know, it was just an enormous boost just prior to the stalemate period. So you will find that when you go to a world where it's ready, the overlap is ready to happen, the stalemate time, there will have been really heavyweight teachers just prior to this in the world, building up an enormous atmosphere of, you know what, there's something beyond the cycles of existence. There's something way better than the cycles of existence. And that we want that. That is what we really want. We don't want these cycles anymore. And so you go into this stalemate period with this high aspiration, and then that enables you to carry it through. And there may also be like a new teaching or a clarification of old teaching, like A Course in Miracles, that comes on the scene just at this overlap time. I mean, when I was aware, before A Course in Miracles was published or anything, I was aware that it was going to be, I always knew there was going to be this great, great book come into the world that is going to be supremely helpful for us. And when I found the book in 1978, I said, this is it. This is what I was telling everybody. As a child, I was telling you, listen, all these books you're studying now, there's something coming that's way better, and it's going to be super helpful for you. So don't despair, don't give up. And I said, this is it. So you may find a really, really clear teaching right before the stalemate time. So these factors will be, you'll have allies to help you through it. But you must be serious and try as much as you can to have faith that you're doing the right thing and you're not wasting your life, because it is very difficult. There's no question that the overlapping of cycles can cause you to seemingly get off track, and you want to try something, a cycle two, the new cycle, and say, what is this like? You know, what's the idea? I said, well, I wonder what this cycle is really like. Let me find out this. And I said, it's not so good. And so you will have difficulties for sure. But you have to, if you have a sense, this is an overlap, you see, this is a stalemate period. It's my opportunity to realize I don't want this death-based training program at all. And the Holy Spirit has a life-based training program for me. And I'm going to get into that. If you can just keep that as central, and you realize the continuity problem is the only problem there is, then you will minimize your distractions. And when you start to get off track, you won't get off track for too long of a time. Now, let me show you one other thing here. Okay. Cycle one, cycle two, the stalemate period is the overlap. Now, what happens is when cycle two starts overlapping cycle one starts saying, help, I feel like everything is disintegrating, we're being attacked, and I'm calling out for heroes, I need heroes to help, will you please help strengthen the institutions and the ways of this cycle one, so it's not taken over by this barbarians of cycle two. So help, 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 help. Also, cycle two says, hey, this old cycle one was terrible. They're barbarians, and we have the answer. So won't you please help, 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 help us supplant this, because we're having trouble here. They're really putting up stiff resistance, and we must beat back these barbarians of cycle one. And so they put out the call, help, 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 help. Now you, in the middle here, during this 33-year overlay, stalemate period, if you're a real sensitive, responsible, very intelligent, capable person, as you no doubt will be, you hear these cries for help, and you're being marketed to, because you got the capacity to be this hero. And cycle one is saying, be a hero to us, and cycle two is saying, be a hero to us, and you feel torn apart by this. And you try to please both of them. You try to please both sides. You may try to do both at once, and then you'll feel completely messed up, and then you'll say, well, let me help one side first, and then I'll go help the other side. And then you feel like you're working against yourself and getting nowhere. And then you say, well, I can't help either side. And then you feel you're letting both sides down, and you're useless. So it's really troublesome, actually. Very, very troublesome. I mean, definitely I was recruited by both sides, both cycles, heavily recruited. And both sides wanted me to provide a musical soundtrack for what they were trying to do, because music is super strong marketing device, actually. I was asked to compose church music that would help strengthen the cycle one and help people say, hey, you know what? This has got better music than cycle two, you know, as part of an overall campaign. You know, who has the better music? The problem was that cycle two, they like electronic machine-based music and mechanical singing. And so for them, this, you know, the old beautiful cycle one music is, yeah, barbaric stuff, terrible. So it doesn't really attract anybody from cycle two, really. And then I actually tried to help cycle two out with synthesizer stuff. I did some really great electronic music, you know, but cycle oneers didn't like that. And I tried to blend the two, you know, and then neither one liked it, neither side. You try to please both cycle one and cycle two, you'll please nobody. So, it's incredibly difficult as you get pulled in both directions simultaneously, and the only answer is the Holy Spirit, and just keep listening to the high true teachings. Gradually, you work your way out of the guilt of not being a hero, not being able to help, etc. But I believe if you understand that the continuity problem is the only fear we have, and it's driving all these cycles entirely, and that the people from cycle one won't tell you this, and the people from cycle two will not tell you this fact. They don't. Where do you get in the teachings of cycle one, where do you get this, that the continuity problem is the only problem there is? Nowhere. Where do you get in cycle two? Nowhere. Okay. So if you don't have this realization that the continuity problem is the only problem there is, you're going to be very vulnerable to trying to help out either one or the other of these cycles, or both, and feel tremendous guilt and fear if you don't help either. So I have found that this recognition that the continuity problem is actually the only problem we have is like the antidote to this time of stalemate, that helps you get free of the guilt and helps keep you from being torn apart by, you know, competing factions vying for your loyalty and support. Because they most certainly are very aggressive in trying to line up their support. Just as like the liberals are incredibly aggressive in those who support them. I mean, they're just relentless, as the conservatives too. The cycle one people, will call them the conservatives. They very much are trying to, you know, line up their support and very, very adamant about it. And cycle two is better at their marketing, actually, which is, you know, why they're winning. And it's inevitable they're going to win. It's inevitable. Because the staleness of cycle one, the fact that it didn't work, all this stuff is working against it. You cannot maintain cycles forever, because the people just say, hey, it hasn't worked for me. I'm still stuck. I still feel fearful. I still, you know, I need something new. Give me a new drug. You know, and along comes this new drug, cycle number two. So, it is not easy to deal with the situation. But the better the teaching you have, the easier it is. It gives you some leverage. So, it is possible to get through these cycles. And hopefully, I have done so successfully. We'll see. So, what's next is the question. What's next? I don't really know for sure what is next, but it will certainly be revealed shortly. There's no question that the foreshadowing I've been getting is that very soon it is going to be revealed of where we stand now, because this we're now the stale time of stalemate is coming to an end very quickly, abruptly. You know, it is really closure on it. And the world will decide, okay, we are now moving on, period. You've had your time. Either get with the program or we're going to re-educate you, basically. And we're at that time. We're at that juncture now. We may have like a one-year period of final warning from Cycle 2 people of saying, look, you've got this last-ditch grace period. After that, you're either with us or completely against us, and we are going to, you know, put you out of sight and out of mind. No question about it. So that is why what they're trying to do in Congress right now, United States Congress, is to delay the Affordable Health Care Act for 1 year. They're fighting tooth and nail for that. And I don't know what's going to happen with that. This is very interesting. There's no question I've seen that re-education camps, the plan is to those who don't go along with Cycle 2 will be interred. They will be interred in these resettlement camps, processing camps, re-education, processing for re-education. You know, there are plans to do that, absolutely. Because the patients of Cycle 2 will be over. They're very impatient. They are chomping at the bit to go forward, and they want everyone on the same page. They want a global government. They want the whole planet to be on the same page. And they want everybody wants to know what you're eating for breakfast and, you know, tweeting and everybody monitoring everybody else. That's why all this social networking, you know, is taking place. Is so there's this collective monitoring, a hive mind like, to make sure that nobody is getting off track. No such thing as getting off track here. It'd be quickly corrected. Like, oh, so it's an amazing like global religion, or call it global dictatorship, global fascism, whatever you want to call it. You know, whether you want to use a pejorative term or a positive term. There's no place for those who dissent. There is no place for dissension. And that is will become apparent very soon. So here we go. At least I got this information out to the world prior to October 1st. October 1st is a drop-dead date as far as the Cycle 2 has planned. It knows it has its timetable. It knows that starting in October of 2013, this is it. They're going to decide. Everyone's going to get on the same page, like it or not. You know, this stalemate is over. So they have planned for this. They have planned for civil dissent. They've planned for mop-up operations. They've got all the materials, the logistics, the planning, the places, the camps. Everything is in place. If there happens to be, you know, civil dissent, if there happens to be, and they you know, whether it'll be or not, is, and how much, you know, is up in the air. But certainly, they're aware, and the blueprint is moving forward. So, I would expect the Holy Spirit will step in with its blueprint and say, here it is, to those who are have the ears to hear. They'll say, look, here is my blueprint. During this time now, starting in October probably. I've always had these spiritual breakthroughs have always happened towards the end of October for me. Where the blueprints of the Holy Spirit become revealed. So I absolutely expect that. That October will be the month of revelation for us. And we'll become aware of what our options really are, what the Holy Spirit's blueprint for us is. Relocation, what's going to happen? We will find out probably within the next month. So this video is very crucial. Being able to present this in a graphic format like this, save my eyes from trying to study. I can't use my on the computer as far as graphics. My eyesight gets so bad I can't even hardly drive. But using this chalkboard, it doesn't affect my eyesight. So it's a big help. So let me visualize this for you. October, month of revelation for us. Okay, just allow that to percolate within. October is going to be the month of revelation, where we become aware from within of what the blueprint is going to be going forward, because we have to have this now. Time is up. You know, we either can accept it or not accept it, but we have to now say, okay, I'm going to become aware of this. I'm going to become aware of what my options really are, and then I can choose. You know, if you don't feel ready, you say, no, I'm not ready to choose. Well, we have to be ready to choose now in October. So don't be afraid of it. Just say, okay, let's take a look. I've been saying the last day, I said, okay, I'm ready to take a look. Let's just take a look at this and see. Let's just take a look at this and see what's available for us. Very important. So we have October coming up, 2/13, starting on a Tuesday. Okay, now what I have experienced over the years is around towards the last week of October, I've had the incredible revelations. Sometimes on the 27th or the 28th, that'll be a Saturday and a Sunday towards the end of October. Quite a few times over the years, over the decades, during this latter part of October, that's when the blueprint has been revealed to me, and I become aware of the possibility of being free from duality, from free from the continuity problem, and it's been a progressive revelation of clarity. So I expect as we go through October here that there's going to be tremendous revelations take place. So we're starting this Tuesday, we get going on October. So we're almost done with September, thank God. Actually, it's been a lousy month, to be sure. Pivotal month. Pivotal meaning people are choosing either, you know, cycle two, pivoting to cycle two and saying, okay, it's it, finished. I'm pivoting my attention, it's it. Or not pivoting to cycle two and realizing that they're going to get crushed and then deciding what to do about that. Or pivoting to October in terms of the Holy Spirit revealing the blueprint of its option. So I'm really looking forward to October, I'll tell you that. Very optimistic and trying to shake off the dust of September. One of the most awful months ever. As this realization sets in that, you know, it's over. The stalemate period is over. That it's scared. I was just trembling and shaking, horrible. All my muscles were shaking and trembling, and I said, wow, what's going on? It's because it's over. It's finished. The stalemate period is finished, and you either made it or you didn't, as it were. To some extent, right? And this is what's really going on. So, Thursday would be the last day of this. 31 days in October. Full month. And so let us set our sights on October at this point. Let us set our sights. Take a big breath and the next 2 days start to orient towards October. And say, this is the month where I'm going to get it. I'm going to get it. I'm going to see the blueprint. I'm going to see my success. My success is going to be revealed to me. The way to succeed the way to happiness, true happiness, is going to be revealed to me, and I accept it and I embrace it. Start getting into that frame of mind. I'm already getting into that frame of mind. That is the next step for us. And we take it, we try to take it 1 month at a time here, actually, and give full devotion to that month, of what that month is about, the significance of that month, and make the very most of that month. So October, month of revelation. And that's going to be a very good thing, and I will help us all. We'll work through it together and make the very most of it. Now, if you're not going along with either cycle one or two, you may be feeling very jittery right now. You're saying, oh my gosh, what do I do? Well, that's what we have to find out. So just hang in there, keep breathing. And very, very soon it will be revealed. For instance, last night I had a dream, and I was in some kind of like stadium where you could look at the sky, beautiful sky, and suddenly all these cloud patterns came in. Now, I've never seen anything like it before, and I was astonished at the intricacy and beauty of the flowing of these cloud patterns. A swirling and beautiful tapestry and weaving of all these cloud patterns, and the sky was just stupendous. And I said, oh my gosh, I wish I had my camera. I knew if I didn't bring my camera, something great would happen. The thing is, you cannot use cameras cannot capture the beautiful, subtle visions of spiritual vision. They cannot capture it at all. In fact, yesterday I was sitting right here, and the sun came in at a certain angle, and I saw all the dust in the air. It was incredible. So streaming, all this streaming of dust particles. The air is actually full of dust particles, saturated with dust particles. We don't even see it. I took the camera and tried to focus in and capture it. I could not capture it. I could not. Also, at times, I've been able to see the moisture in the air. I'm able to defocus, and you're able to actually see it, and it's just incredible pouring of the atmosphere of water, tiny water droplets everywhere. Okay, this was a little different. These were actually dust particles, because the water vapor has a different look to it. But you can actually, I've been able to visually see that. I'm able to do that and see like fine mist, but super fine mist. There's a super fine mist at certain times. You can just, and you can see it just moving about like that. But also dust particles in the air. But we can't capture it with our cameras. But what we see with our spiritual eye cannot be captured by photography or by cameras at all. And we might feel like, oh, if I could only capture this and show it to people what it looks like, then they would be interested. And I've tried to simulate some of this stuff with a lot. I spent a lot of time on visual effects and try and give some feeling of what it might look like, but it's not the same. It's not really the same. And so we just have to actually step into this spiritual vision and see for ourselves what is there to see. And don't expect to embrace it right away. I think the best we can hope for is some sort of objective noticing it and saying, oh, okay, this is interesting. This is interesting. That's all we have to do. We don't have to do anything more than that to start off with. It's just because there's too much fear involved for us to really embrace it. Just the very fact that we're able to step into any sort of subtle spiritual vision indicates enormous escape from the fear of the continuity issue, an enormous escape from it. So certainly I expect in October that will take place at some point in time, that there will be awareness of subtle vision, of seeing something that the body's eyes cannot see. So these are the times. I mean, we are now here. If we can just accept where we are, is going to be a huge help So we'll keep on working on this issue. Okay, time to wrap this one up. It's been a good one, and I hope you enjoyed the use of these graphics. Maybe it helped a little bit. Okay, that's it.